Thank you, Member Chair, so very much for those words. Our next speaker is the Right Honourable David Steele, MP. Here, my task is very easy, for he is truly one of the few people in the country that everyone knows, so I will need to introduce him. Member of the Privy Council and leader of the Liberal Party for so many years, he has, of course, been one of the key voices in the political debates of our era. As John mentioned, state and religion need each other, and in an ideal world, form a perfect pair in working for the shorter and the longer-term good of humanity. The presence of Mr. Steele here today, in the peaceful garb of Privy Councillor, and with the other political representatives on our platform, in particular our own MPs, Hector Monroe and Lady Lennox, their presence is all very much appreciated. My own prayer is that that will be a token, a symbol, for the balanced future for our own society. Both David and Judy Steele have been very supportive and appreciative of our work here, and their interest in our activities has really meant a lot to us. As people deeply involved with the arts in this part of the world, people concerned with culture and an intelligent, meaningful approach to life, they've shown genuine interest in the aims that we're trying to achieve and the practical way we've tried to reproduce the uniqueness of Tibetan art forms. And this is understandable, as they themselves treasure tradition, the traditions of the borders, and as we've seen in recent years, we are doing so much to keep these traditions healthily alive. I will now ask Right Honourable David Steele to say some words.
Your Eminence, ladies and gentlemen, it was with a very real and deep sense of privilege that Judy and I join you in this opening ceremony today. The religious ceremonies which inaugurated this monastery were of course carried out by the Honourable Councillor. But I'm deeply grateful to the Abbot, my friend Appa, and to the whole community for giving me the opportunity to join with others in welcoming you permanently to the borders. And I pray that you all be very happy in these peaceful surroundings, which you have done so much by your presence to enhance, and if I may say so, to sanctify. And I am of course only too well aware of how great a blessing it is for us all to have your community in our midst. The local school is thriving, and many of the foreign visitors we get wending their way up Ettrick and starting to ask, how far is the monastery? At a material level, however, trade and tourism have increased because of your expansion. And your regional council, and your district council, and your member of parliament, Hester Monroe, have watched over these developments with great care for more than the past decade. The centre provides study, retreat, and meditation facilities for Buddhist and non-Buddhist alike. Its aim has been expressed very simply as to increase mental and spiritual well-being in the world, and also to preserve the rich cultural and spiritual heritage of Tibet. It's a place where all kinds of people may find quiet and retreat under the guidance of well-qualified teachers. And all who have worked over these last 10 years are to be congratulated on the splendor and magnificent craftsmanship of the building. I'm deeply grateful to you as a neighbor, but I'm also grateful to you for the fact that you've asked me, as a committed member of another faith, to join with you today. And then, given the sublime nature of your own faith, it's not surprising. For Buddhism is about all the epitome of tolerance and compassion. Two qualities which are sadly lacking and deeply needed in all areas of our life today. And I think it is a tribute to that that you have here the presence of representatives of the Church of Scotland, of the Roman Catholic Church, of the Episcopal Church in Scotland, of Judaism, of Hinduism and others. The great emperor of India, Ashoka, in the 6th century before Christ, who was himself a Buddhist, said this: "He who does reverence to his own sect, while disparaging the sects of others, with intent to enhance the glory of his own, by such conduct inflicts the severest injury on his own sect." And then one considers the savage, murderous centuries of bloodshed that have intervened since those words were spoken. Bloodshed often because of religious rivalry and religious bigotry. We can draw strength from the changeless wisdom that great souls so many centuries ago. And I wish most deeply that some of my fellow Christians would themselves learn a little of that wisdom and of that grace. We all need to remember also, in our often cruel and senselessly violent world, the words of that other great Indian sage and saint, Mahatma Gandhi, who said, "Religions are not for separating men from one another, they are meant to bind them. It is a misfortune that they have become a potent cause for strife and mutual slaughter." And the Tibetan people in exile are testimony to the force of these words. And I remember also what was said by His Holiness Dalai Lama, whom I met in London and who visited here 2 years ago, whose leadership of the Tibetan people I so much admire, along with others around the world. And he said this: kindness is my religion. Those which should be the hallmark of every religious believer, whatever his faith, though this, I feel, is far from a natural reality. But I hope that the peaceful and inspiring presence of the Samuel Ring, and what I hope you will agree with me, are the most beautiful surroundings of our Scottish border hills, will be an ever-increasing source of that compassion, that kindness, that tolerance, which are the signal characteristics of your faith and your community. Politicians tend usually to talk too much, so with these heartfelt words of hope and welcome, I have great pleasure in asking His Holiness to join me in unveiling this plaque, which formally marks the opening of the Calgary Samuel Ling.